some clapping this morning. We have a few songs. We'd love to have you join in and clap with us. And time, we're just so excited to be able to worship here. One of our songs says, our first song actually, "This Is Amazing Grace," says, who brings our chaos into order? And isn't it wonderful that we have a God who can do that with everything that's going on in the world today and feels so chaotic? Who brings our chaos into order? It's the one who gave us amazing grace. And Lord, we love you so much. We thank you for this opportunity to be here. Lord, we ask that your presence would just be felt in this place, that you would give us joy and peace and security in knowing that our hope is in you. And we thank you for your amazing grace in each one that's here this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. And as always, if you're comfortable standing, awesome. If not, we'd love to have you clap with us on some of these songs as well as sing. So join in worship as you're comfortable this morning. We're just waiting for our music. Here we go.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Sing for all that you've done for me.
We do have something to sing about, don't we? Here's my favorite part.
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nation with truth and justice, shine like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Why?
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. The Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Yes, you do. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Who am I that the highest King could welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me. His grace runs. Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place. I'm a child.
sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. My eyes in one.
Let's join our hearts together as we pray. Father, we thank you as we gather in your house, as we gather in this place with your people, Lord, that you will meet with us, because that's what your word has promised, that you have already prepared, Lord, a time in your presence that is designed to strengthen us, to bring healing, to bring hope, and to bring encouragement, and to bring power, because that's what you do. That's what you have designed for us today, because as we gather together in your name, as two or three, Lord, gather, your word tells us that that's where you establish your residency. That's where you pitch your tent. That's where you are today. So, Lord, we know that you are in this place. You are meeting with us as we gather together around this globe via internet. Lord, we know that you have a plan and a purpose for this day. And, Lord, you're the one who said you would build your church. It's your church, and, God, we are a part of that, and we are so privileged and honored to be called your children. So, Lord, we pray that you would just move in this place today. Move, Lord, in the hearts of men and women around the globe as we join our hearts together, Lord, in worship, in focus on you as Lord and Savior and King today. Now, Lord, we pray your blessing on this time. We ask it all in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Turn and wave to somebody. Yeah. That's right. It's great to see you. It's great to see some new faces since last week. We're slowly coming out of our shelters, and it is good to come together. You may be seated. It's great to be in Father's house. We are so grateful to have folks joining with us around the globe via internet. We're doing better this week. We've got the Mevo up. We're on Facebook. We're hoping in the next week or two to be able to be streaming live simultaneously on our YouTube platform as well. We're almost there. Please just ignore that red flashing light. That doesn't mean anything that you need to worry about, except that something's not working. And we're getting there. It's amazing how stuff, when you put in storage for over 3 months and don't fool with it, and you put it back out, you know, like, hey, it was working okay. Actually, it wasn't. I think we had problems with that one beforehand. It's just happy to be back. You're right. Are you happy to be back?
Yes.
All right. Awesome. Awesome. We are so thankful that you are back with us. We have a few announcements we want just to share with you on the screen. You should see scrolling here in a moment some of those QR codes that give you information with regard to our online study guide, which is there. It has all the scriptures and some other information and links for you. So if you just go through those. And if you don't catch it on the screen as Michael scrolls through those, you can catch them in the hallway. They're on the wall. We have a bunch of them. And if you don't know how to use those, just talk to one of our team members out there. Most of you, if you have an iPhone, I think that's a built-in feature. I think some of the Samsungs also have that feature. I'm not sure, but we can get you to take a picture of it, and it will take you right to the site and to the information. So we have the online study guide. We have our communication card if you're with us for the first time, or if you made a decision to serve the Lord and you want to let us know that. Our online giving information is on there as well. We are receiving your physical offerings in the buckets out in the hallway as you enter and as you leave. But we are still encouraging you to use the online forms of giving, where you can give by a credit card, debit card, or you can do a direct bank transfer. That has been a blessing to us during our shelter-in-place time. Our YouTube service playlists, so you can go over the services that we had online, and the ones we'll be uploading as we go along, so you can always review those services and enjoy them and be blessed by them. Our first Sunday prayer meeting invite, which happens to be tonight. We're going to be having our first Sunday prayer group meeting on Zoom. There is a sheet out there, a link that you can go right to that link, but we will be posting that link also on our CIAG family, our church family WhatsApp group as well, so that you can, if you would like to be a part of that, let us know. We'll include you on that group if you're not already on that group. And yeah, tonight's going to be a little special on that because we will be celebrating communion during that prayer meeting, since we're still adjusting and preparing for how we're going to do communion in this new world, in this new age. And since we haven't been equipped or prepared to do that yet in a safe way, we're going to be doing it virtually online, as we have for the last couple of 2-3 months. But you'll be able to join us in a live Zoom setting for that. We just encourage you to have ready during that time. If you're going to join us, just some drink, something to drink, doesn't matter what that is, and a piece of bread for everybody who will be joining with us, and then we'll walk through that process and that celebration of the Lord's Supper together this evening. So that begins at 6 o'clock. You're welcome to sign on anywhere from 15 minutes on before that, just for a time of fellowship, and then we'll get right in to our time of prayer, worship, and then communion. So if you have questions about that, talk to Robin. She'll be glad to fill you in before you leave today. And if you have any questions about how things are happening, or you have suggestions or thoughts, let us know. We're always open to hear that, and we appreciate it, since this is a whole new paradigm for all of us. And I think we're doing pretty good. Amen? Yes. I can't tell if you're smiling at me or you're frowning. Maybe that's good, though. I don't know. Smiling. You're smiling. Well, that's great. You don't have your mask on, so I can tell that. So. But anyway, it's great to be in Father's house. So as we come together with that excitement, God has something in store for each of us if we'll just focus on Him for the next several minutes. I truly believe that. And as I said, tonight we'll be coming together in a time of worship and praise. And as the Bible tells us, that if you want the best from God, then you need to worship. We shared that verse from Psalm with you over the last several weeks on our online service. But we want you to know that worship and prayer is the only thing that's going to make a difference in our world today. Because God is the only one who can change what's happening. Amen? God can change a heart, and that's where things have to start. So we encourage you to join with us. We are in need of some greeters on Sundays to assist us with enforcing our new COVID protocols. If you'd like to step forward and help out one Sunday a month or whatever, just let us know. We really be thrilled to have you step in and join us and help us in that way. And don't forget those popcorn offering buckets. Those are not for popcorn. We're not offering popcorn at this time. We're asking you to put something in if you can, rather than take it out. So that's what those are there for. All right. God has been doing some awesome things. We had for the last 3 months, we're in a series called Survivor. And so now we're coming out of that shelter in place, and we're coming into a new season, and so we're starting a new series, and it's called the new chapter. So you see, when we chose to become Christ followers, when we make that choice, we begin on a journey that guarantees us new experiences and opportunities like we could never imagine. Now that means that God has a plan for your life that you never imagined possible. That journey comes with a series of new chapters being written that require both faith and courage to see completed. We talked about that last week as we reopened in an official way. We said, now those 3 months that we have been sheltered in, God hasn't been dormant. He hasn't been taking a nap. He's been preparing things so that when we came out of that shelter in place, and I used the illustration of coming out of a tunnel, that when we entered the tunnel, things were one way. When we come out of the tunnel on the other side, like the tunnel there that runs under the English Channel, you leave one nation, you enter another nation. It's like going from one world to another. Things are different, and so we've come out of that tunnel. We're coming out on the other side. It's a new chapter. And we're not the only ones that have had to go through that process. When God delivered the nation of Israel from Egypt in the book of Exodus, we're given some incredible examples that illustrate this beautifully. For instance, after Israel had been captive in Egypt for 430 years, they suddenly find the freedom to leave their captivity behind and to explore the new opportunities that God had made available to them. Now take a look at how God began to write this new chapter for them. In Exodus chapter 13, beginning in verse 17, it says, "When Pharaoh finally let the people go, God did not lead them along the main road that runs through Philistine territory, even though that was the shortest route to the promised land. God said, if the people are faced with a battle, they might change their minds and return to Egypt. So God led them in a roundabout way through the wilderness toward the Red Sea. Thus the Israelites left Egypt like an army ready for battle. Moses took the bones of Joseph with him, for Joseph had made the sons of Israel swear to do this. He said, God will certainly come to help you, and when he does, you must take my bones with you from this place. And the Israelites left Succoth and camped at Etham on the edge of the wilderness, and the Lord went ahead of them. He guided them during the day with a pillar of cloud, and he provided light at night with a pillar of fire. This allowed them to travel by day or by night, and the Lord did not remove the pillar of cloud or pillar of fire from its place in front of the people." Now, that's a very important point to remember, because you're going to see how that plays a role in just a few moments. See, the first thing God did for newly freed Israel was to lead them down an inconvenient route. Now, for many, it must have been rather confusing and concerning. There were no doubt those among the newly freed people who spoke up and said, Hey, tell Moses we're going the long way. Or perhaps they said, hey, tell Moses you're taking us the wrong way. You know, and how many times do we find ourselves in that situation when God starts to take us in a roundabout way? We start to talk to God, hey, God, you're confused. We should be going over this way, or we should be doing this. But God had an intentional reason for taking Israel the way he did. See, we're not always clear on what God is doing because we don't have the perspective that he has. We're immediately introduced to the fact that God had a reason for his choice of routes, even though it would take them longer to get to the promised land. Too often, we fail to listen to God when things don't make sense to our limited minds. Part of the problems that we face in our world today is that we don't take the time to listen before we start complaining and griping. Have you noticed that? Sometimes it's so easy, and the natural thing for us to do is just to begin to complain, to gripe, and to protest, or whatever it is you want to call it. You see, the direct or the fastest route for Israel to have taken would have, by the way, taken them directly through Philistine territory. Now, in case you're unaware, the Philistines were a kind of nemesis to Israel throughout their history. They were a ruthless and a constant enemy who sought the destruction of Israel. In fact, the story of David and Goliath, well, that was a little young boy David fighting Goliath, the champion warrior of the Philistines. Just to give you some context there. So these Philistines were constantly out to destroy Israel. So if this newly freed nation of people were to have encountered this vicious and well-prepared and equipped army in their state of mind and body, remember, they had just come out of 400-plus years of servitude, slavery to the Egyptians, making bricks without straw and doing all of this stuff, and they were a beaten-down nation of people who freely, who had just recently found their freedom, their newly freed people, and very much unorganized in the way in which they work together. So God knew that it would be devastating to them, both physically and spiritually, if the first thing out of the gate, out of Egypt, would be a war or a battle with the Philistines. It would have totally demoralized them. And as we find throughout the wanderings of Israel leading up to their getting to the promised land, there were many, many, many times when they just wanted to go back to Egypt because that's the comfort that they knew. Many things that God does in our lives won't make sense until we begin to listen to His voice in the midst of our own confusion and anger. Sometimes we just need to learn how to be quiet and trust Him unconditionally. As God begins a new chapter in our lives after 3 months of shelter in place, we have to realize that He may not take us down the main road or the fastest route to get us to where we want to go. In fact, He may not be taking us where we want to go or where we thought we were originally headed. That's an important thing to understand. For Israel, He was taking them to the edge of the wilderness, ultimately, to what appeared to be a dead end, or as I like to call it, a cul-de-sac of impossibility. You know what a cul-de-sac is. That's one of those places where the road leads you to this round place where there's no way out except the way you came in. There's nowhere to go. And that's exactly what God did for Israel. He led them to a place where there was no place for them to go. There was the Red Sea on one side. There were mountains on the other side and heavy fortresses on another side. And that's where God led them. And for Israel, there was no doubt that God had led them to where they were because, well, He began leading them with unmistakable clarity. Remember what it said in Exodus 13, 21 and 22. It said, "The Lord went ahead of them. He guided them during the day with a pillar of cloud, and He provided light at night, a pillar of fire. This allowed them to travel by day or by night, and the Lord did not remove the pillar of cloud or pillar of fire from its place in front of the people." That's very important. Why? Because when we find Israel in that place, that cul-de-sac of impossibility, that dead end as it seemed, they were there because that's where they had followed God to. See, God even made provision for those who feared the dark. Aren't you glad that He does that? He cares about those. He gave us a nightlight. And so that we couldn't be confused about where He was taking us. So this really gives us something to consider when we are faced with a new chapter in our lives. Now, there are many ways that we face new chapters. It might be with a new career choice. It might be, well, like coming out of shelter in place to a world that has changed with all of the COVID-19 policies that we have now got to adjust to, face mask wearing and all of that stuff. There are so many different kinds of new chapters that we find in our lives that God leads us through. But after more than 400 years, Israel had lost her edge and ability to fight and trust God. How do we know that? Simply because every time they faced the slightest challenge, they wanted to go back to Egypt, to their comfortable and familiar misery. And sometimes we find ourselves in that same way. When we run into difficulties, we have this tendency just to want to go back on autopilot, to do the same things we used to do, we always did. We found comfort in a form of misery. Yeah, it was miserable back then, but it was something I was familiar with. It wasn't new, and it wasn't making me do things differently. And Israel was much the same way. But God had turned the page in a new chapter for their lives. God had heard their prayers and shocked most of them by sending a Moses to lead them out of their captivity. How many times do we find ourselves praying and praying for God to do something, and then he does it, and we almost miss it because we didn't really expect him to do it? Or he did it in a different way than we thought he would. And here, they were looking for something simple. They wanted God just to change things. Wouldn't that be wonderful if God just says, okay, when you wake up tomorrow, everything's going to be perfect the way you've been praying. Wouldn't that be awesome? It really would be. I mean, I would love that because that would mean I don't have to do anything. See, it's great to believe God will do something, and he does promise us to make changes in our lives, but he says, you know what? I think it would be awesome if you participate in this process. No, God, that's really not what I was thinking. I was thinking, you know, you do it, and I'll just step in, and, you know, no problems. The likelihood is that Israel had probably imagined things differently. They probably expected to just take over Egypt without having to put forth much effort. And like I said, that's the way most of us imagine God's answers to our prayers. But the reality is that God usually requires us to trust him in ways that we have never had to trust him before. He says, you want freedom? Then trust me and follow me. You want healing? Trust me. You want a job? Trust and obey me. Now that sounds pretty simple and easy until God makes what we perceive as or consider to be a wrong turn. You say, okay, God, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to follow you. And then all of a sudden, he goes a roundabout way. And you say, no, God, that's not what we agreed on. And he says, well, those were my terms. Trust and follow. You see, part of the process of deliverance for Israel involved teaching Israel to trust God and to obey him. You may recall that Israel ended up where they were in Egypt because they had lost that ability to obey God and to totally trust him. It was a form of discipline. When God writes a new chapter in our lives, it has to be that, a new chapter. We can't go about business as usual or as we used to do it. There has to be changes in our lives. Since God doesn't change, what does that mean? If God isn't the one who's going to change, if things are going to change, what has to change? It has to be me. Because the Bible says that he never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, forever. And we're asking for change, and God says, okay, you want change? Where's it going to begin? It's going to begin with you, with me. New chapters are designed to give us a new beginning or a fresh start. So think about that as we embark on this new chapter. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, Paul says, this means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a, and you know what it says? A new person. The old life is what? Gone. And a new life has what? Begun. So what does that tell you? That tells you that when we become a Christ follower, that there are going to be, or should be, there must be changes in our lives, in the way we do things, the way we approach things, the way we think about things. So we can't approach that new life the same old way, or we will end up with the same old life that we struggled with before. Does that make sense? See, new chapters can be filled with excitement, or they can be filled with fear, depending on how we approach them. And as we turn the page, we may not know what the chapter holds. But if we have confidence in the author, we can have certainty that it will turn out well. And that's an important distinction. You can have confidence without certainty. So there are a lot of us who don't have confidence in God. And so that certainty that he promises us isn't going to be there. But if we have total confidence in God, then we can have certainty that whatever happens is by his hand. On the edge of the wilderness, Israel faced an unknown future. But understand this, just because it's unknown doesn't mean it's uncertain. So when we face unknowns, we can still have certainty because of the one in whom we have put our trust and the one that we're following. As they followed that cloud and that pillar of fire, they didn't know where it was taking them, but if they understood who it was that was behind that cloud and behind that fire, they could have certainty that they were going to be going where God wanted them. See, each of us face unknowns all the time, and we don't have to face the unknown with uncertainty. What our faith and trust in Jesus Christ assures us can be something that can control every aspect of our life. And he does give us the promises of assurance and certainty as we trust him. David wrote in Psalm 23, verse 4, the famous 23rd Psalm, he says, "Even when I walk through the darkest valley, I will not be afraid. Why? For you are close beside me. Your rod and your staff protect and comfort me." Now, David didn't say, "Even if I walk through the darkest valley." What did he say? He said, "Even when I walk through the darkest valley, I will not be afraid." See, there are some certainties that David had. He said, I know I'm going to face dark valleys. And we have to face life with that reality as well. The enemy is going to make things difficult for us at times. But even when that happens, we don't have to be afraid. Why? Because we have certainty that he will remain beside us. Why? Because he said, "I will never leave you. I will never forsake you." His rod and his staff protect and comfort us. I read a quote this week from Pastor Rick Warren, who said this. He said, "Your focus will determine your feelings." Think about that for a second. Your focus will determine your feelings. Isn't it amazing how what we spend the most time focused on will influence how we feel? Now, I don't know if you have ever had a chance to wander through an art museum. I've had the privilege to spend a lot of time in the National Art Gallery at the Smithsonian Institute in Washington, D.C., because I grew up very close to Washington, D.C., and many of the school trips we would take almost every year would always take us to the Smithsonian Institute, and the National Art Gallery being there, we would wander through there and have that great privilege to see some of the great works of art around the world, as well as I've had the opportunity, the great privilege, to visit the Louvre in Paris. And I have found it amazingly easy to feel the emotion that many of these artists intended if you focus on the painting hard enough. Most art lovers will tell you that it is possible to lose yourself in a good painting. It has the ability to convey emotions and feelings simply as you focus on it. You can feel the anxiety of an approaching storm or the joy of a sunrise. You can feel it as you focus on it. Life has the same ability to convey emotion and feelings by what we choose to focus on. We can choose to focus on the ugly and the negative and the hateful, or we can focus on how God is present and working in the midst of the chaos. I often like to refer to Peter's first, and as far as we know, his only attempt at walking on water. He was doing fine until he began to focus on the wind and the waves. Do you remember it? It's Matthew chapter 14, beginning in verse 29. And Jesus said, "Yes, come," as Peter asked if he would invite him out on the water. So Peter went over the side of the boat, and he walked on the water toward Jesus. So far, so good. But, verse 30, when he saw the strong wind and the waves, he was terrified and began to sink. "Save me, Lord," he shouted. Now, started off really good. Walking on water, that's pretty awesome. He was walking to Jesus, his focus was on Jesus, and suddenly his focus changed. And he's not unlike us in many, many ways. There are a lot of times when we come out of a situation where God has led us and God has done something awesome, and we're so excited, we're really pumped, we're really ready to face the battles and things that are ahead because, hey, look what I just did with God's help, blah, blah, blah. And then all of a sudden, immediately, we are introduced to another challenge or another focus, and our eyes get off what God just did and onto what we face now, and suddenly everything he just did just seems to melt away. Just imagine if Peter had remained focused on the presence of Jesus on those waves. Now, let's get back to Israel for a moment. It wasn't long before the Israelites in that cul-de-sac that God had led them to on the edge of the wilderness, on the banks of the Red Sea, suddenly looked back. They had to, because God was in front of them, and behind them is where they had come from. And somebody must, in the back of the crowd, turned around, just thinking about where they come from, and all of a sudden they see it. They looked up and they saw approaching Egyptians on chariots. A cloud of sand rising there behind them in the distance. Exodus chapter 14, beginning verse 10, says, "As Pharaoh approached, the people of Israel looked up and they," what? "They panicked when they saw the Egyptians overtaking them. And they cried out to the Lord, and they said to Moses, 'Why did you bring us out here to die in the wilderness? Weren't there enough graves for us in Egypt? What have you done to us? Why did you make us leave Egypt?'" As far as I know, that was a choice. "Didn't we tell you this would happen while we were still in Egypt? We said, 'Leave us alone. Let us be slaves to the Egyptians.'" Sounds like a great choice to me, right? "It's better to be a slave in Egypt than a corpse in the wilderness." But Moses told the people, "Don't be afraid. Just stand still and watch the Lord rescue you today. The Egyptians you see today will never be seen again, and the Lord himself will fight for you. Just stay calm." All right, listen, what happened? Once again, Israel became influenced by what they focused on, the approaching Egyptians. Now, I can understand the concern as you look back and you see this army coming at you, but what were they missing in this picture? What else is in this picture that we're not seeing because we're looking through the eyes of Israel for a moment? Well, it is this one important thing. You see, had they looked up instead of looking back, they would have seen something even more overwhelming than the entire Egyptian army. They would have seen either a pillar of cloud or a pillar of fire watching over them. You see, God had led them to that place, to that time, and it was all there in their new chapter. See, God never left them. He led them. He was there watching over them, but they were focused not on God who had just delivered them from Egypt. They were looking back to the Egyptians. Their focus is what caused them to panic. So how about you this morning? What are you focusing on? What are the challenges that are trying to grab your attention today? And there are lots of them. I understand that. There's a lot of things that are really trying to grab our focus and attention today. It might be the headlines from the news about things happening around the world. It might be the COVID-19 virus still raising its ugly head. It might be challenges at work, or maybe a business that has been affected because of the shutdown. There's so many things. Your family, so many things that the world's going to say, look at this, look at this, look at this. What's your God going to do about this? The challenges are the things that can take our eyes off of the presence of God. Remember, the cloud and the fire never left Israel, but they took their eyes off of it and focused on the Egyptians. And sometimes we can do the same thing. God has never left us. He's never forsaken us. He's still in the picture, but we are not focused on that part of the picture. We're focused on the things that the world and the enemy wants us to be distracted by. Are you focused on the route that you're on, or the one who was leading you? See, Israel got caught up in the way in which they were going rather than the one that was leading them. Are you focused on what you have left behind or what God has laid before you? It's an important question. You have to address that question. What is it that makes you uncomfortable or uncertain in your faith or your following Christ? Is it the things you've had to leave behind in Egypt, or have you lost sight totally of the promises that God has made you for what He has in store for you ahead of you? Are you focused on what you think you've lost or what you have gained? Are you focused on what the world is telling you to focus on, or what God is telling you to focus on? Because it makes a difference. Boy, the world is so good at telling you, hey, this is what you have to think, this is what you have to feel, this is what you have to look at, this is what you have to make a priority in your life, because nothing else matters. And if we follow that directive, then we are sure to get ourselves filled with anxiety and issues that take our eyes off of what God is saying. God is saying, look, I'm right here. You have a choice. And he speaks softly most of the time. He doesn't, you know, smack us and say, hey, over here. Sometimes I really would love to do that with people sometimes when they get so distracted by the world. I'd love to be able to, you know, slap them. Hey, wake up. God's here. I mean, I know you parents must feel the same way at one point or another. You just say, hey, focus, focus, focus. It makes a difference what we choose to listen to. All of us have embarked on a new journey, and we've turned the page to a new chapter that's written by God. I believe that completely. So don't keep going back over the previous chapters. They're done. Now let's look ahead to what God is doing today. It's so easy to get caught up in what used to be, the good old days. You know what I found out about the good old days? Most of them weren't really that great. Right? I mean, some of us have had an experience to remember what some of the good old days here in Cayman were like when the mosquitoes started to come back. Anybody experience that? These mosquitoes. We got used to the way things, you know, had been, but we forgot about the way things used to be. And a lot of other things as well. And God says, no, listen, I'm doing something new. It's better than the old days ever could be. Don't lose sight of that. This morning, some of us need to let God establish our focus. We need to begin to focus on Him rather than the things that the world has totally bombarded us with. Because that's the only hope that there is for change in the world is change in me. You can point to everyone else and say, you need to change, you need to change, you need to change. But the reality is, I need to change. It's got to begin with me. Because when you begin to change, then the world has started to change. And then others will change because of what they see have happened in your life. We're going to bow our heads in just a moment. We're going to pray, and I'm going to invite you to pray with me as we invite Christ to take charge and become the focus of our lives and to help us to keep that focus where it belongs and where it needs to be so that we can face the new chapter with excitement and not with fear and anxiety. Because the new chapter is going to have a lot of stuff in it. It's going to have good stuff. It's going to have challenging stuff. It'll have bad stuff. But the reality is the hero remains the same in the chapter. He doesn't change. Amen? Amen. Because I don't know where the chapter will take you, except I know as long as you are following the hero, the one who's writing that chapter, that it's going to end right where it's supposed to for you. Unless you go off on a tangent, following something that you're not designed or intended to follow, that will lead you away from God's plan. So bow your heads with me. We're going to just say this simple prayer. Make it your personal prayer to the Lord this morning, and God will begin a new chapter in your life that all of us need to begin at some point or another. Bow your heads with me. Let's pray together. You can repeat after me. Father, thank you for loving me so much that you sent your one and only Son, Jesus, to die in my place, to begin a new chapter in my life, in this world, as we put our faith and trust in Him. Help us to remain focused on you. Don't let us become distracted by the world and all of the challenges that we face around us. Never let us lose sight of the cloud or the pillar of fire, because you haven't changed, but I need to. I ask for your forgiveness and give my life to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Are you ready to face the new chapter? Because God has some awesome things in store for each of us. Let's keep the focus on Him and not keep looking back and saying, you know what, I really miss this or miss that. Yeah, we all miss a lot of things. And we'll miss a lot of people. But you know what? God says, I've got greater things in store for you. I've got greater things ahead. Keep that focus where it belongs, on Him. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now, if you prayed that prayer with me for the first time or the first time in a long time, God's already begun the process of change in your life. He's turned the page. He's written, it's a blank page, and He's beginning to write that new chapter. You just need to be a part of it and trust Him, follow Him, and let Him lead and guide you. And I would invite you to please be sure to use that QR code there. You'll find out for the communication online communication card. Let us know what decision you made this morning. If there's any change in your information that you would like to provide us with, or you're here for the first time, let us know that. Please fill that out for us. But right now, let me invite you to stand, and we're going to just worship the Lord as we come to the close of this service together. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you.
nations. Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting there with open arms. For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son to save us. Whoever believes in him will live forever.
Amen. Hey, tonight we invite you to join us for a time of prayer and worship and communion. Check out the QR code for the Zoom prayer group that meets tonight, or you can join our CIAG Church Family WhatsApp group and talk to Robin as well. We'll get that information out there for you. And so right now, let's bow our heads as we close in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for meeting with us. We thank you, God, that you've never left us. And Lord, that as we have emerged from our shelters, God, as we have come through the end of that tunnel, we've come into a new world, but the same God, you haven't changed. And your power is the same yesterday, today, forever. Your purpose and your plans to use us, Lord, to make a difference hasn't changed. And God, I pray today you will help us to remain focused on you and not allow the distractions all around, Lord, to take us away from that path that you have chosen, because that's the only path we want to be on. Whether it's the short one or the long one, we want to be where you are, because that's the only place of safety. That's the only place of victory. Now, God, as we leave this place today, Lord, empower us to be witnesses, to be, Lord, testimonies of your love and your grace and your power, Lord, to change and to give hope and a future. We ask it in Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
amen. Amen.
And now the service begins. So have a great week and let God use you. Amen.